Hello everyone and welcome to my third session on operating system classes. So I have already taken two sessions. So in my first session I covered about introduction to operating system. In the second session I covered about process management. And this is the third session, and in this session I will cover introduction to threads. And if you have not watched my previous two sessions, I will highly recommend you to watch those. Like, both are of 1 hour each, but they cover the topic in details, so you will be able to understand what is operating system, how process is managed in operating system through my previous two sessions. So you can find the link to those sessions in the description of this video. And in this, of course, if you see a title, I will be covering introduction to threads. So okay, before I proceed, I will just request you to subscribe to my channel if you have not done so, because that encourages me a lot in making more videos like this on computer science and about my work and sharing with all of you. Okay, now coming to previous session. In my previous session, I covered about what is the difference between program and process. So I covered about process management. In that, I covered about these subtopics, like difference between program and process, what are process states, what is process control block, process creation using through fork, like what are exec, wait, exit system calls, and at last, zombie and orphan process. These all I covered in my last session, second session. And this session, like, it will be like a, I will say, there will be a total of 8 sessions in which I will be covering the whole operating system syllabus. That can be useful for your interviews, for your semester exams, or for any other exams, like for which you are preparing. So this will cover all the basic concepts of operating system. So after you have like gone through all these sessions, you will be good with like basics of operating system. I will not say only basics. I am also teaching more than basics here, but of course you will be like, these sessions will be enough to cover like the basic concepts. Okay, the agenda is like, I will start with covering the inter-process communication first, like how different process communicates with each other. Then I will move to what is a thread. Then famous interview question, that is difference between a process and a thread. Then multi-threading and multi-processing, what is the difference between this. And at last, I will cover multi-threading models and challenges with multi-threading. What are the challenges with multi-threading? So these are all the subtopics that I will cover in this video. Okay, and also in every session, I also cover what interview questions can be asked that are related to this topic that I am covering in this session. So through this session, you will be able to answer these interview questions, like what are the similarities and difference between a process and a thread, what is IPC or inter-process communication, give some examples of IPC, why process coordination is necessary in operating system, what are advantages and disadvantages of using shared memory and IPC, what is multitasking, multi-programming, multi-threading and multi-processing, then what are the challenges faced in multi-threading programs. So these questions can be either interview questions or your questions in your semester exams, right? It can be anywhere. I mean, these are very basic questions for operating system. And there are some more questions, like difference between Chrome and Firefox in terms of multi-processing and multi-threading, difference between a named pipe and an unnamed pipe, and at last, what are the benefits of multi-threading. These all questions can be asked. Okay, the first topic here is inter-process communication. So basically, how different process communicates with each other, multiple process communicates with each other. So we will look into that now. So first look at, so we have two types of process. So one is independent process and one is cooperating process. So there is difference between these two. Like, independent process do not share data with other processes. So those are independent process. They are not dependent on any other process. Cooperating process are those process which are dependent on some other process, because maybe they are sharing data with the other process, right? So they are dependent on it for the data. So of course, does a process share data with the other process? So if it shares, it is a cooperating process. If it does not, it's an independent process. Also, for independent process, debugging is very easier. So if you have some errors in the program, the debugging is very easier, because that process does not depend on any other process. But when you have cooperating process, debugging may be tough, because that process coordinates with other process. So you need to, I mean, debugging of course can be tough here, right? Two processes are communicating here. Now first, let's look at why process cooperation is necessary. So, okay, why do not we only use independent process? Why to use cooperating process, right? So let's look into that, why it is necessary to use cooperating process. So there are four reasons to use cooperating process, like the need for process cooperation in operating system. So the first one is, of course, information sharing. So if you have a cooperating process, they can share information with each other, and that can be very useful in operating system. I will show you, I will give you some examples of like how it can be useful later on. Like when you see the examples of like, okay, I will talk about that later. Then you will understand how this is very useful. The second point is computational speed up. So computational speed up is like, if multiple process can share data, what you can do is, if you have a very big program, so this is your very big program, let's say, you can divide this into smaller programs. And this, I mean, this smaller program, let's say program 1, 2, 3, this all can share data with each other with the help of cooperating process, right? Or with the help of process communication, they can communicate with each other. Now, once you have broken them into smaller chunks, now you can increase the, I mean, how this, so if you would have run this program, single program on the CPU, it would have taken you maybe, let's say, T1 time. Now, if you are broken down this program and you run this program on, let's say, CPU one, this on CPU two, and this on CPU three, right? Then what can happen is, let's say the time taken now for running the whole program is T2. Now what will happen? Normally your T2 will be lesser than T1, because these all are running parallelly each processor. Now that program will finish fast because of that. That's why I'm telling T2 will be lesser than T1 in this case. And your program has basically become faster when you have broken down that into smaller modules. Of course, the next point is modularity. So here I told you, right, you have broken down the program into modules. So modularity is, of course, useful for maybe computational speed up, of course, but there are other usefulness of modularity. So see, if you have a very big program, like containing 3000 lines of code, now if somebody has to maybe add some new piece of code, or if you have a new joinee in your team and if you want to explain him the code, then it may become tough because that's 3000 lines or 4000 lines of code. But what if you have broken down into logical modules, like let's say the code for amazon.com. So amazon.com, of course, there will be a code base for this. So what if you have broken down this amazon.com code base into logical chunks, like there is a separate code for payment, there is a separate code for maybe, let's say, checkout, separate code for listing items, separate code for showing your recommendation, right? You get it, like I have broken down into multiple modules, and each module is very logical and independent from other. And of course, if you want to share data among others, of course you can use, I mean, in case, let's say they want to cooperate, of course you can use a process, I mean, communication, right? Of course you can use that. The last one is the convenience. So this is like, if you have process cooperation, take the example of your desktop or your laptop. There you are able, because of process cooperation, you are able to listen to your music. At the same time, you are able to open a browser. At the same time, you're able to do multiple things at the same time. If this process cooperation was not there, maybe it would not have been possible to do that. So that's why convenience is also provided when you have process cooperation. So these are the four reasons for that. So let's now look at what are the models or types of inter-process communication. This is very important. I will also give examples of them. This is also very important. What are the types of inter-process communication? Okay, now you understood, right, why inter-process communication is necessary. Now let's look into types of process inter-process communication. First is, of course, the shared memory. So in this, what happens? A region of shared memory is first established, and once this has been established, then processes, multiple processes, can share information by reading and writing to this shared space. So this happens a lot. So you will see this a lot, I mean, happening a lot. Like when you use threads, right, you are actually doing the same. You are using shared memory when you are using threads. I will cover this later when I discuss about threads, but that's what you are doing when you are using threads. You are using shared memory concept. Then the second type of inter-process communication is message passing. So in this, what happens? A link is established between two or more processes, and then over this link, messages are shared. I will show you the examples of this, how this actually happens. You will understand this more. This is just the theory part, but I will show you the examples also how this actually happens. Okay, this is a diagram which shows actually how this happens. So this, look at the second diagram, B diagram, which shows you the shared memory. So in shared memory, if you see, this shared memory area is first established by process A and process B. After that, they both can read and write to this shared area, right? That's how they can communicate. Like they can create a variable and they both can share the variable. They both can read to this variable and also write to this variable. Similarly, both can maybe create a file and both can read from that file and write to that file. So this is this way shared memory happens. Next one is message passing. In this, what happens? In this case, actually kernel is involved. This is very important. So I am not telling that in shared memory, kernel is not involved. In shared memory also kernel is involved. So when you are creating this shared memory space, of course, this is like you are creating some new memory. You are asking for some memory, right? So it is the function of kernel to do that. So of course, system calls are involved, but after once you have got the memory, shared memory, then you both can write to there, both can read from there. There is no kernel involved there. And of course, if you use mutex and other semaphore others, of course, kernel is involved, but normally it's not involved. So when you do a thread programming, when you create the threads, okay, kernel is involved. But after you start writing and reading from some functions, their kernel is not involved. But here what happens, if you have to communicate in message passing, first, the link has to establish, and then kernel will help you in basically communication. So take example, let's say process A wants to communicate with B. So they can use some system calls. Let's say the system calls are send and let's say receive. These are system calls that A and B can use for communicating. So what A will do is so first let's say the link establishment has been done. Let's say that has been done, then it will so this is the system call that A will use. Okay, sorry, not to A, to B. So A will ask the kernel, okay, send this message to B, then it will go to the kernel. This system call will go to the kernel, then kernel will see that this is a message and it has to be delivered to B. So what kernel will do is it will then deliver this message to basically process B. And this, if you see, the communication happened, right? Message went from A to B. So that's how communication happened in message passing. And I will give you real life examples also, because this is just a theoretical example. I will give you a real life example, like how this happens, message passing happens. But before that, look into the differences between shared memory versus message passing. So message passing, of course, is useful for exchanging a smaller amount of data. Shared memory is useful for exchanging large amounts of data. This is because, message passing, you are sending data to the kernel, right? And through some link. And it depends on the bandwidth of that link, right? How much data it can handle. That's why I'm telling if you send a large chunk of data over that link, it may happen that the communication may become very slow. But in shared memory, what happens? You already have the memory here, right? Whatever data you want to fill it here. If you want to like push more data, okay, ask the kernel to allocate more memory, right? It's very easy, right, in that case. And then keep on writing and reading from this memory. That's why shared memory is useful for exchanging large amounts of data, and message passing is exchanging smaller amount of data. Of course, message passing is easier to implement in distributed system. So, okay, one example of message passing is the socket programming that happens. So how different internet devices, right, they communicate with each other using socket programming, like send and receive system calls. That is the example of message passing. So that normally happens on distributed system. You will have one internet device in India, other internet device can be in US, and both are communicating, and it's distributed, right, distributed globally. And it's quite easy to do message passing there. But think of doing the same with the help of shared memory, right? It sounds very tough, right? How we can maybe, I mean, So if you have two distributed systems, one in India and one in US, and you want to share data with the help of shared memory, I mean, how will you do this? I mean, it's quite tough, right, to do. I'm not telling it's impossible. Of course, it's possible. There are ways of doing this, but it's tough to implement, I mean, this concept. That's why I told you it's tough to, it's not easier to implement. Of course, if you have single machine, it's very, very easier to implement. You ask the kernel for some memory and start sharing. But how to share, I mean, data on the network, right? For that, message passing is, I mean, more easy. Of course, message passing is slower than shared memory because I told you system calls are involved. In message passing, every call has to go to system call. Then system call kernel will then deliver the message to the other process. That's why this is quite slow because you are involving kernel here and kernel will take some time. Of course, this is faster than message passing because when you are reading and writing to the shared space, mostly the kernel is not involved in that case. Now let's understand more this with real life examples. So of course, shared memory is achieved using multi-threading. This is one of the way of using achieving shared memory, that is multi-threading programming. In multi-threading, when you have multiple threads, all the threads will share a common piece of memory and all the threads can read and write to this memory. So that's shared memory, very simple example of shared memory. For message passing, you have some examples like sockets. I told you about sockets, right? Socket is a famous example of message passing, socket programming that you do. Pipes is there. I will tell you more about pipes in details after some time. And also you have remote procedure call. I will not discuss much about remote procedure calls here, but they are similar to socket programming. I mean, you are communicating with some other devices mostly in RPC also. Then you have pipes. Pipes, there are two types of pipes actually, ordinary pipes and named pipes. Or this ordinary pipes can also be called as unnamed pipes. So basically you have two types of pipes, unnamed pipes and named pipes. Okay, let me dive into this in details so you understand these real life examples better. So socket programming, if you have not done socket programming, maybe if you are in third semester, fourth semester, right? Maybe you have not taken a networking course. Okay, you will not be aware of socket programming. But this socket programming actually helps in like whatever the communication is happening on the network or the internet, that is done by the help of socket programming, where you bind a socket. You create a socket first, then you bind the socket, then the server listens on the socket, then the server accepts a connection from the client. So you have client and server model. So client is basically you, and the server is like Google server or LinkedIn server, which is basically somewhere in US or some other countries, let's say. Now you will basically, I told you, first the first thing is to establish a connection. So you will first establish a connection with the server. So once this is done, you will send a data request. Like you will say that, okay, your browser will basically send the request. So your browser is the client. It will send a request that send me the Google page. Send me the page for homepage for google.com. This is the request. And this will be normally done with the help of, I will say, read system call. Right, read system call, it will be used. And then what will happen, once the request will reach the server, it will process this request and it will use the write system call and it will reply with this, with the write system call, and it will basically travel over the network and reach your browser, and then the browser will basically render that home page on your browser. That's what happens. This is a famous example of message passing. So if you see message was extend, right? So what is the message here? So the message here is the google.com HTML page that was transferred from here to here, from server to client. And also one message, also this data request also got transferred from client to server also. That is also a message. So this is like, okay, and okay, you will think how I am telling this is process communication, inter-process communication, because this client is actually running some process. The browser is itself a process itself, right? Your browser is itself a process. Here also, somebody is processing your request. That is also a process. So that's why I am telling process communication took place here, or inter-process communication. Another famous example is pipes. So if you are using terminal a lot, you would have used pipes, unnamed pipes a lot, like this command, ls, then grep hello. Let's say I'm giving some simple example. So this will basically search all the files in the current directory and give the output the files that have hello in that. file name that is hello. Other can be like cat file name, grep hello. So this is actually the pipe operator. This one, pipe operator. This is the pipe operator actually. And what is pipe op? Okay, you will think how inter-process communication is happening here. See, this is happening something like this. Ls is a command which you are running. Now it will basically output something, right? Now if you use the pipe operator here, the output will be passed to the next command that you are writing here. That is grep hello. So basically what happens, ls is also a process or a command. So this is actually a process itself. Grep is also a process. Now you want to pass the output of ls command to grep command, right? So output of ls command should be an input to grep command. Now if you use the pipe operator, this will help in passing that. So that's why I'm telling here again, inter-process communication took place. The output of this was transferred to input of grep command. Of course, other than you have, so this is unnamed pipe, then you have named pipe also. So the issue with, okay, I will discuss that. So in named pipe, what you can do in Linux, you can use make FIFO command, mkfi FIFO and file name, and it will create a named pipe. And I will discuss the difference between named pipe and unnamed pipe. So unnamed pipe can only be used to communicate between parent and child process. So ls is the parent process here, right? You are passing the output of parent process to the child process, that is grep process. But it is not with named pipes. In named pipes, so let's say you have created a named pipe, let's say, and the name is named pipe. So this is basically a file that is there on your disk. This is the pipe file that is there on the disk. Now any process, so this is basically like a FIFO queue. So you have basically a FIFO queue kind of thing. And now any process can read to this, or and any process can write to this. There is no, I mean, limit on this. Like, okay, only parent can pass the output to a child or something. Any process can read, write to here, and any process can read from here. So that difference is not there, this difference here. Also, a named pipe exists on the file system, or it's permanent on the disk, on your disk. This is not with this unnamed pipe. Once you have run this command, the pipe disappears, right? It is not permanent, but these named pipes are permanent on your disk. Also, named pipe can be used for communication over a network. So if you host this named pipe file on your network, then of course you can communicate on the network also, right? Again, named pipe is bidirectional. If you see, this is unidirectional, right? You can only pass the ls command output to grep. The reverse you cannot do here, right? But in this case, named pipe is bidirectional. I mean, you can also read and write from this. Both you can do in named pipe. You cannot do the same in unnamed pipe. So this is all about inter-process communication. And I have given you the theory of like what is the difference between, I mean, what is inter-process communication? What is the need for inter-process communication? What are the types of inter-process communication? And I have given you a lot of examples here to show you like how inter-process communication works. Now you should be clear with these concepts. Now let's move to the second part, that is what is a thread. We will discuss about multi-threading, multi-processing here in details. So a thread is a basic unit of CPU utilization. This definition is very important and this makes sense a lot. Let me explain you how this definition makes a lot of sense. So let's see, what does a thread consist of? A thread consists of thread ID, program counter, register sets and stack segment memory. Normally these four are the important parts of a thread. Now think about this, what does CPU need to execute instructions? So CPU needs actually registers and program counter. I mean, this program counter is also stored in some registers. So normally the CPU needs like registers to execute instructions, right? Now think about a thread and CPU, right? So thread also has all of this, all of the data that is actually used for, I mean, executing instruction on the CPU. It does not contain other information. It only contains the information that is needed to run the program or instruction on the CPU. So of course, leave thread ID, but this program counter, register sets and stack segment memory, these are very useful for running an instruction. So that's why it's a basic unit of CPU utilization. So process is also a unit of CPU utilization, but not a basic unit, because the process contains a lot of other information also, like what are the list of open files, what I mean, also memory information about like heap memory, data memory, and I mean all these memory, right? So process contains a lot of other information also, but thread only deals with these four information mostly, and CPU also deals with all these information. That's why a thread is a basic unit of CPU utilization. Now let's understand what a thread shares with other threads. So there is a difference between process and thread in the sense that a thread shares some data with other threads. So of course, these four are unique for threads, but they also share something. So these four will be unique for each thread, these four things. But there are other things that they will share, like code section of memory, data segment of memory, heap section of memory, open files, signals. So these all they will share with other threads. So this is very important to understand. So that's how they differentiate between threads and the process. A process does not share all of this with other process, but a thread does. So that's a very, that makes a huge difference actually. So basically, if you see the difference is that threads share a lot of resources with other threads, but process, they do not share resources with other process. So within process, if you have two process, both the process will contain like separate code section of memory, separate data segment of memory, separate heap section of memory, separate open files, separate signals. But if you have two threads within a process, both will share these five. And also, this is just some, extra knowledge. It's okay, good to know about this, how Linux actually implements threads. So Linux has a unique implementation of threads. So through the Linux kernel, there is no concept of threads. So in Windows, actually, in the Windows operating system, they differentiate between a process and a thread. So they call thread as a lightweight process. But Linux does not differentiate much between process and the thread. So Linux, what it does is Linux implements all threads as a standard process. I will show you how it is done. Each thread has a unique process control block. So a process has a process control block. Thread also has a process control block. In Linux, I am telling. In Windows, it may be different. And to the kernel, it appears as a normal process itself. Only difference being that threads just happen to share resources, which process do not. Only this is the difference that Linux sees in threads and process, nothing else. Threads also has process control block, process also has process control block. Only difference, you understood this, right? Only difference that, understood this. So let's say this is the PCB for a process, process control block. In that, different information like PID, registers, I will say stack memory, heap memory, data memory, a code segment memory. These all are stored in PCB of process. Let's say you have PCB of thread. This also you have PID, registers, stack, heap, data, code. The difference here is that if let's say process, of course thread are not independent, they are created within a process itself. Let's say that thread was created in this process P, then what will happen is these four parts will not be duplicated for this thread. So this stack pointer, let's say this is a pointer, this will just point to this stack point, this pointer. This will just point to this, this will just point to this, this will just point to this. So this all will basically share the stack will be different. Stack should not point. Stack should be unique for both. But all the other three sections of memory, each will just use a pointer to point to this. They will not make a duplicate of this heap memory, data memory, and code memory. So that's the how Linux implements this, right? It's quite easy for Linux, right? They will just use a pointer to point to it. It becomes quite easy. See this, how threads implementation happens in Linux. So when you are using, fork is used for process creation. When you use a fork, you can create multiple process. Now in this, what Linux does is, it normally uses this clone system call. In previous Linux versions, fork used to be a system call, but now it's not so. Fork is just a, API, that is a library itself, and clone is the system call for creating process or thread. So using this clone system call, the Linux can differentiate between whether you are creating a process or whether you are creating a thread. So if you see here, in this you are just sending the sick child signal. So that is like a parent normally waits for its child, right? And some signal will be sent when the child process is killed. So do not go into advance of this. I'm just telling that if you see the parameter passed here for creating process, it's just this one parameter. See the parameter passed for creating a thread, right? You are passing like clone the virtual memory, clone the files, clone the signals, right? So that's what how the Linux differentiates. When you use this system call, thread is created. When you use, system call is same, but when you use these parameters, of course, process is created. When you use these parameters, you get a thread. So of course, thread, if you see, the parameters passed are so that they can share the memory and files. This is another diagram to show the difference. If you see, this is a single threaded program. So see, even if you have a process does not have like multiple threads, in that case also you have a single thread of execution, because thread is mostly concerned with this thing, right? Code, data, mostly code and registers and stack, right? That is a thread. So every process has a single thread of execution. But in case if you have multiple threads, like three threads here, if you see here, each of these is sharing these three, right? All are sharing this code, data and files. But for each of this, the registers and stack are different, right? That's how this happens, between the difference between process and thread. In process, everything will be duplicated. In threads, only, all will share these three things, and this all will be created new for them. Okay, I have already discussed the difference between process and thread, but let's revise here. A process is a program in execution. Thread is, of course, a part of a process itself. It's not a different, independent entity. It's a part of process itself. You cannot create a thread without a process. First, you create a process, then you can create multiple threads within that process. Takes more time for creation. Of course, it will take more time because you have to reduplicate all the memory. Here, you do not have to reduplicate all the memory. You only have to create a separate stack memory. Other three segments of memory remain same. More time for context switch here, less time for context switch here. This is because, this is related to memory management. So what happens, every process P has a page table associated with it. So this page table actually helps in converting logical address into physical address. Now, see what will happen. And also in context switch, what happens, you have normally CPU here. There are a lot of registers. And in one of the registers, the base address of this page table is stored. So every process has a unique page table. So of course, the base address will be unique. And there, a base address is stored in the registers. Now when context switch is happening, the value in these registers needs to be changed. When the context switch is happening between different processes. Why? Because each process has a separate page table. Of course, you need to replace this register with the base register of the new page table, right? But think in terms of threads. In threads, each thread is sharing this page table, right? Each thread does not have different page table. All are sharing this page table because this page table is basically a memory mapping, and the memory mapping for all the threads are same. All the threads within a process are same. For them, when threads are context switching, threads within the same process are context switching, the kernel does not need to change this register value, the base register value. That's why I told, less context switch time. Of course, consumes more resources. When you are reduplicating the memory, it will consume more resource, more memory. This consumes less resource. And this is a basic difference that makes all the difference. Actually, memory is not shared. Here, memory is shared. So only stack memory is different for process and thread. For multiple threads, if you have multiple threads within a process, the stack memory for all the threads will be different, but other three segments of memory will be same. Now let's continue the differences. Process communication is complex, but it's easy and efficient for like when you have threads. Of course, in threads, it's quite easy, right? You create a shared space and write and read to it, right? Quite easy. Process communication can be tough, like when you want to write, use like socket programming or maybe RPC or pipes, it can become tough. The program code itself can be quite, because there are system calls there. So it can become quite tough, but thread programming is quite easy, I will say, than this. The one disadvantage with threads is that if one thread crashes, all the other threads will also crash. This is a disadvantage with threads. For a process, it does not affect the other process. If one process crash, it does not affect the other process. And this is, I will talk about this when I talk about Chrome and Firefox at last. Now, do you understand why a thread is called a lightweight process? Do you understand this? If somebody asks you why a thread is called a lightweight process, so you understand this. It's a lightweight in the sense that a thread is sharing a lot of resources with other threads. That's why it's light. A process is reduplicating a lot of resources. That's why it's heavy. Understand this difference. Okay, now you've understood what is thread, difference between process and thread. The famous interview question. Let's now move to multi-threading and multi-processing. Of course, multi-threading is when you are using multiple threads within a process. So when you have multiple threads within a process, it's multi-threading, quite simple. So multi plus threading, multi-threading. It should be also supported by hardware. See, if you have only one CPU, or I will say one core, and I mean, if you write a multi-threaded program, it's of no use. Because your hardware only supports a single thread. Even if you write a multi-threaded program, it will not make it faster. Understand this. So that's why hardware support is needed. And also understand the difference between concurrency and parallelism. Both are different. So you will think that both are same, but both are not. So concurrency is like, okay, concurrency is kind of, I will say, it's almost parallel, but not actually parallel. Okay, I'll show the difference here. So concurrency is something like this. So this is your CPU here. You have one CPU here, and let's say the CPU, this is the time interval on which the CPU will run. Let's say this is the time interval. Now some process will keep on arriving. So the CPU will, what it will do is it will give some time to P1, next to P2, P3, P4, again P1. So this round robin fashion, so basically this is the role of kernel itself. The kernel will use round robin scheduling algorithm, and this will keep on happening. So this is concurrency. Why? Because every process is getting some slice of CPU time, let's say 10 milliseconds. To the user it looks like it's parallel because it's happening very fast. Like they are browsing, they are typing on the text editor, everything is happening very fast. So to the user it looks concurrent, right? It's almost concurrent, it looks like. But this is how it is implemented here. But parallelism is different. Parallelism will be faster than concurrency. So in parallelism, what happens? You have multiple CPU. So P1 will be running on this CPU, P2 will be running on this CPU, P3 will be running on this CPU. And this will be very fast. Because P1, so in this, there was context switch was happening, right, between process. But this context switch was happening very fast. Here it's not so. Each one is running on a separate, I mean CPU itself, so this will be very fast. So this is called parallelism, and this is called concurrency. And concurrency can happen also on single CPU itself, right? That's what I showed you. But parallelism cannot happen on single CPU. You need multiple CPUs for, I mean, parallel programming. Also, most applications are multi-threaded today. Like most of the applications you see on your desktop or laptop, your browser is multi-threaded. Your web server, you do not have a web server, but let's say Amazon, Google, they have a lot of web servers, and all the web servers are multi-threaded. Even word processor that you have or text editor that you have, they are multi-threaded. So browser is multi-threaded in the sense that a browser does a lot of stuff. It renders the content of the HTML on your browser. At the same time, it also has to fetch this information from the web servers. So it will be using multi-threads to make this faster. Similarly, web servers, like, see, Google will be handling like requests from you, from your friends, from everyone, from your family, and a lot of users globally, right? So it has to make this very fast. So it will use multi-thread and handle all these connections separately. Similarly, word processor, if you see, it is also displaying you graphics. It is also waiting for your keystroke, right? It is waiting for you to type. It is, when you type, it is also doing spell checking. So there are a lot of functions it is performing. And if it uses only a single thread, then this will be sequential and it can be slow. To make it fast, what it will do is it will use multiple threads. One thread will help in displaying graphics. One thread will help in waiting for keystroke. Other thread will help in spell checking. That's how it can make fast. Of course, but now you understand benefits of multi-threading. Of course, responsiveness is one of the, I mean, you think of browser and word processor. I mean, if let's say, if you're not using multi-threading, the response time of the browser or word processor will be slow, right? Because browser will first maybe fetch the information. After fetching the information, it will start rendering, right? So, and also if you open another tab and open some other site, it will be sequential and it will take a lot of time. Similarly, word processor, the spell checking can be slow if it is running on a single thread. When you are typing, normally spell checking is very fast, but now when you are typing, after you type, it will do the spell check, so it can be slow. Of course, benefits of multi-threading is resource sharing, like threads share memory and resources by default, so of course resource sharing is there. Other is economy is there. Economy in the sense that when you are creating multiple process, right, they are costly in the sense that you are duplicating a lot of resources. In multi-threading, it's not so. In multi-threading, you are not duplicating a lot of memory, like you are sharing those. So that's why it's economical. And of course, last one is scalability. It increases the parallelism. Like if I have given the example of web servers, how they can handle a lot of clients using multi-threading. So these web servers can scale a lot in this sense. Also understand what are the challenges for multi-threading. This is also very important. Like what are the challenges for multi-threading? So multi-threading is very, I mean, good concept. It's very fast. There are a lot of advantages of it, but there are some challenges here also. So one challenge is that there are concurrency issues that can happen. I will show you that with the example. Like this will happen like when multiple threads trying to update the same resource at the same time. At that time, it will lead to race condition. So I will explain this with an example. It will become very clear. So think of this. When you write I++ in your code, let's say, so what happens? What do you think? So actually, of course, this instruction gets converted into machine level code, and then the CPU will execute this. But what are the instructions involved here? So I++ is actually a combination of three instructions. I have not written the instruction name here, but I have written what those instructions actually do. So the first instruction will get the current value of I from the main memory and copy it into a register, because CPU has to execute this instruction. So that's why the data first has to be fetched from the RAM to the register. After this, the CPU will add 1 to the value stored in this register. So the CPU has ALU with it. This ALU, I'm arithmetic and logical unit, this will help in adding 1 to this value, whatever initial value of I is. And then again it will be stored in the register. But finally, the CPU will write back this, I mean, updated value to the main memory. Okay, these are the three instructions involved. Let me show this with an example. Like when you take an example of, let's say your initial value of I is 7, let's leave the final value, and you have two threads which are trying to increment I. So think about this. When you create two threads, both can, so okay, let's say this is a function, maybe you have a function increment. This is the function increment. You have a global variable I, the value is 7. In this function, you are doing just I++. Then you have, let's say, main function. In this, you are creating two threads, T1 and T2. Then you are doing, let's say, T1 start. I am just writing some pseudo code here. It's not actual code. T2 start, let's say. You are starting both the threads or running both the threads. Now, you do not know, both can actually start executing this function at the same time. This can also happen. I mean, you do not know about the order, whether both can start at the same time, or it may happen that first T1 execute then T2, or opposite can also happen. It all depends on the kernel scheduler, how it schedules it, because both has started. Now it depends on kernel when it schedules this. So that's why concurrency issues can arrive. Now I will show you what issues can arrive here. See this. Okay, now this code is there, so you will basically run this program. So of course this is your, let's say this is your RAM. This program is loaded. In the RAM, I is 7, let's say it is stored at this memory address, let's say. Now you have CPU here, it will have registers. So okay, let's say this is a time T1, I will divide this. This is a time T2, this is T3, this is T4, T5, T6. I've divided this into timeline. So T1 of course is lesser than T2, T2 is lesser than T3. This is a timeline. Now let's say this is the sequence. So first at time T1, thread 1 gets the value of 7. That it gets the I value to the, it basically copy the value of I from RAM to some register. Let's say this is the register here. It's copied. First step is done. Thread 2 does not do anything at that time. Next is increment I to 8. This will CPU will do, right? Using the ALU, it will increment this to 8, let's say. It has incremented. Again, thread 2 didn't do anything here. Again, last step is write back this I to the main memory. So this will be written to here from 7. The final value became, let's say, 8. That's good. Now, after T3, at T4, so this has finished. The I++ has finished. Now, at this, thread 2 actually starts executing the I++. So it will get the value 8. So okay, let's say same CPU is executing this. So let's say it will get the value from here. Okay, let's say in different register here. I'm just using, to make it clear, I'm using different register. Then it will increment to 9. So it will do to 9. And then you write back this. So it will write back, update, it will update this to 9. So this will happen, right? Everything is good here. The final value got 9. Two threads were there. Initial value was 7. So last value should be 9. That's quite good. Everything is good. Now understand this one. In this case, the issues can happen. Understand this very clearly. Again, you have RAM here. You have started running the program. Initially, I is 7. Now again, divide this. Sorry, divide this into T1, T2, T3, T4, T5. Okay, there are only T5 here, let's say. And let's say, okay, we will take two CPUs here. Let's say this is CPU for thread 2. It has registers, 3 registers. So CPU for 2. You have this CPU for again. Okay, I will, okay, this is CPU for, main memory will be same, but CPU is different. CPU for 1. It also has registers. Now at time T1, so I told you, nobody knows about when these two threads will execute. It depends on kernel scheduler. It can start both at the same time. If both start at the same time, and they will both will get the value of I from main memory. So this also gets, let's say, into this register, and this this is for thread 2, this is for thread 1 CPU. Now this gets into this register. Both have got the value from main memory. Now at time T2, for this nothing happens, because maybe this was maybe removed from that CPU. Context switch can happen, because that all depends on the process scheduler. For this, what happened? It was still running, and it incremented this to 8. Now at T3, this maybe got context switch, this process. Thread 1 got context switch, and this increased this to 8. All good. At T4, what happens? This is writing back, the thread 1 is writing back 8 to here. So it will write here, I mean it will update here from 7 to 8 I value. And thread 2 didn't do anything. At T5, of course, this is complete, this will not do anything, but this is again writing back the value of 8 to the main memory. So it will also write, update it here, and overwrite 8 to again 8, same value. So if you see here what happened, the final value was 8, it's not 9. That's why I told concurrency issues can happen in this case, right? So that's the issue. You were expecting the output to be 9 because two threads were there, but output is actually 8. And if you see what is actually happening is that, since it consists of 3 instructions, I mean both are clashing somewhere, right? In that case it's happening. And this is called a race condition, because both the threads are racing to update this value. That's why it's race condition, and this can cause issue. This is very dangerous actually, the race condition. And also identifying this is very tough. We'll discuss a solution to this in process synchronization chapter when we cover that. Okay. This was all about like what are the challenges to multi-threading. Let's now move to last part, multi-processing. So of course, multiple processes within a process is multi-processing. You use fork for creating multiple process. Of course, process creates any time consuming than creating threads, I've already discussed. And of course, process address space is not shared among multiple process. So of course, multi-processing will be normally slow because of this. Okay, let's also understand about CPU cores and hyper-threading. So a core is basic computational unit of CPU. So CPU is normally like you have a hardware chip. On this there can be a lot of cores. Now each core is a basic I mean computational unit of CPU. Each of these cores will have registers and ALU and all. This also will have different registers. So each of these cores has registers. So this is basically a core, and this whole thing is basically your processor chip or CPU chip. So similarly in the case of process, right? You have processes. Within processes, you have multiple threads. Also here also you have a hardware chip like CPU chip or processor chip. Within a chip, you have a lot of cores. So okay, this I have explained. A CPU has initially a CPU had only one core. In old times you had like CPU with only one core, but today you have dual core or quad core. Dual core means you have two core processor. Quad core means you have four cores. So now in modern operating system, you will have dual core or quad core. Then you have again another functionality called hyper threading. So if hyper threading is enabled on your hardware, what will happen? It will allow a single core to run two threads. So logically two threads. So it will make your system very faster, I will say. So, okay, now what will happen? Let's say if you have four cores and you have also a hyper threading enabled, then you can run 4x2 threads at the same time. So that's the advantage of using hyper threading. If you do not have hyper threading, then each of these four cores will only run like four threads. Understand this. So basically hyper threading, you get additional resources for running threads. I'm not discussing this in details. You can maybe Google it and understand it more. So this is the hardware overview for me. So if you see here, the important thing is here, the number of cores, number of processors. Of course, I have one processor chip. A number of cores is of course 4 in that, and hyper threading technology is enabled here. So I can run 8 threads at one go in this because of hyper threading is enabled. Now this is a debatable thing, like when to use thread versus process. So threads of course are very faster than process, but there are some disadvantage with threads also, like crashing one thread crashes other threads. There is also no security between threads. Because you saw that, right? In that example, it led to race condition when multiple threads were trying to update the same variable at the same time. So of course you always have to do a trade-off between speed versus reliability. So these two conditions are not very reliable, right? It makes your program more unreliable. But threads also increase your speed if you have multiple threads, the overall speed increase happens. Take example Chrome versus Firefox. In Chrome, multi-processing is used, and in Firefox, multi-threading is used. You will see that in Firefox, if one thread crashes, your whole Firefox will basically hang. In Chrome, it does not happen. But Chrome normally you will see it consumes a lot of your memory and CPU. You will see that. Just open the five Chrome tabs and see like how much this Chrome processor are using your resources. You will see that. Open 5 Firefox tabs which are using multiple threads and see the resource utilization. You will see the difference there. Of course, but in web servers, word process and computer games, which need to be very fast, like the response time in this needs to be very fast. In this case, mostly multi-threading will be more beneficial. So let's understand between multi-programming, multi-threading and multi-processing. This is just the last part, coming to last 10 minutes. Multi-programming, multi-threading, multi-processing. So multi-programming is simply ability to run multiple programs concurrently, right? Even if you have a single core, you can have multi-programming, because I am discussing, this is important, concurrently. It should not be that, okay, all the programs are running parallelly, but they should be running very fast. Like I can switch very fast between Chrome and text editor. I can also listen to music on my system. I can do all this at the same time. So if you have single processor also, through round robin scheduling algorithm and context switching, this can happen. Multiprogramming can happen. Multitasking is similar to multiprogramming. In old times, they used, some operating system call their process as task. Some will call them as process itself. So it's quite similar to multiprogramming, because you are able to perform multiple tasks at the same time, right? Of course, multi-processing and multi-threading is different. Of course, multi-programming can use both of these if they want to, multi-processing and multi-threading. But even if they do not want to use it, still you can do multi-programming with the help of round-robin scheduling algorithm. Multiprocessing is, of course, you know now, right? Using multiple cores for executing multiple programs in parallel, right? Multithreading again is similar to multiprocessing, but here memory is shared. I mean, you're using threads instead of process, and it's quite fast. Okay, multithreading models, I'm not going to explain here. So there are three types of model, like normally how the kernel thread, how the user threads are mapped to kernel threads. This is not asked in many interviews, but if you are preparing for semester exams, this can be asked. So do prepare this also if you are preparing for semester exams. So there are three mapping, 1:1, n:n, m:n mapping. So I have pasted two links here. Just watch these two videos and you will get a clear idea about these three models. I have also mentioned difference between them. So if you are preparing for semester exams, maybe you can watch this video and you should be good from this. Okay, so the next session will be on process scheduling algorithms, where I will discuss about different process scheduling algorithms in details. Like I will cover all the process scheduling algorithms with examples, their advantages, their disadvantages. Yeah, so thank you for watching this long video, and of course do not forget to subscribe. Thank you.